is actuators, and then what is a smart objects, and how the sensors and actuators are connected over network. We saw different types of sensors, different types of actuators, and how these smart objects are connected through wired and wireless medium. So that was my last topic last week, say on Friday we did. And it's really easy, people. You just want to know what is a sensor. You have to know what is an actuator, and then a smart object. Please remember, there's a mild difference between all these things. You people know what exactly, but you should know what is those terms indicating. I told you what is a sensor doing. Sensor will only sense whatever it has to do. For example, temperature sensor will only sense the temperature. It doesn't do anything. It gives the information, it transmits the signal to the processor. The processor will ignite the corresponding action by using actuator. Got it, people? So what the actuator will do, based on the action that it has to perform, your actuator will do. Okay, so IoT, the basic building block of IoT is my smart objects. What is my smart object? An object which consists of sensors, actuators, processor, along with a power supply, some communication devices, all put together is your smart object. So I think you all got the clear difference between sensor, actuator, and the smart objects. And when these sensors and actuators are connected to the network, we call it a SANET. S for sensor, A for actuator, N for network. So I'm not going to tell more about it. So let's go for the next chapter in your syllabus, which is connecting these smart objects. People, now we know what is the smart object. I told you a smart object is a device which has a sensor, actuator, processor, CPU, power supply, communication, all embedded in one chip. We call that as a smart object. Now, a very important thing is how the smart objects are all connected. Okay. So basic, there are certain basic criteria that you have to, abide when you're connecting this smart objects. Okay. So the first one is the basic criteria that you have to follow is, the first one is range. Okay. Second one is frequency bands. First one is range. Second one is frequency band. Third one, power consumption. Power consumption. Fourth one, topology. Fifth one, constrained devices. Topology. Fifth one, constrained devices. Sixth one, constrained node network. People, you believe these points will cover half of the chapter. I'll make it really simple for you. I have just noted down few points for you, which is not actually required. I think I started the recording. Janardhan sir or Pushpanathan sir, anybody here? So please check whether the recording has started, sir. Pushpanathan sir, Janardhan sir. Okay. People, let's listen now. I'll make it very easy. This will comprise half of your chapter. So if you listen, you can write it by yourself. There's no extra divisions that you have to learn. So I'll make it really brisk and very fast for you people, how these objects are all connected. First one is the range. Okay. Here, the ranges are, it's very simple, people, how long your signal has to propagate between these objects or devices. We call it as range. Okay. How long is that signals will propagate between the smart objects? For example, let it be a wired or wireless. We have to see the area of coverage. We call it as range. If you write these 3 points in a different way, this point is covered. The first constraint that you have to see is how this, what is the range that you have to fix when you're connecting the objects. You got it, people? Whether it is wired or wireless, the area of coverage that you are going to transmit the signal from a device to a human or to the processor, we call it as range. Basically, in IoT technologies, in any wireless access landscape, we divide the range into 3 forms. Okay, the first one is short range, then comes the medium, and then comes the long range. Okay, people listen. This is there in the notes in a PPT. You have to just listen. It is very easy. We'll finish off the range in another 1 minute. So I told you the range is nothing but the area of coverage that the signal propagates between the devices to the human's processor, whatever it is. Okay, whether it is connected, wired or wireless. We divide the range into three. That is short range. For example, Bluetooth people, that is when you connect device to device, we call that as a short range. You got it, people? Example, short range. Then what is my long range is my 2G, 3G, 4G and 5G networks. You got it, people? Then what comes the medium range is the IoT access technologies that we are going to learn in another 10 minutes. Okay, we have a different IoT access technology, which is IEEE 802.15.4, which I'll teach you in another few minutes. Okay, so what comes in the lower range, people? Bluetooth. What comes in the higher range? All my 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G generation. What comes in the medium range is all my IoT access technologies. Okay, what is that IoT access technologies? In another 2-3 minutes, I will tell you what it is. So now got the first constraint that when you are connecting the device, what it is? Range. What is the range? Area of coverage. Everyone got it? Shall we go for the next one? Okay, next one is... Okay, people, I'll just give you in one more explanation for the short range. These short ranges are usually covered by either a small wired or a small distance between two devices. I gave you an example of Bluetooth. When it comes to medium range, I give you an example as a Wi-Fi. For long range, I gave you 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G. Okay, so when it comes to Wi-Fi, there are two types of Wi-Fis available in current situations, people. That is licensed and unlicensed. What do you call the range? Okay, what is this license and unlicenses? Like how you are connecting the objects and how they are communicating, the IoT technology, everything is same. What is the difference between licensed and unlicensed? Whatever the data that you transferred between the objects, okay, won't be reliable, or there can be interferences happening when you are sending the data between the devices and the object. Where when you go for licensed, they will give you an assurance that whatever the data being exchanged between the sender and the receiver is true. When you go for unlicensed Wi-Fi's and all, they won't give you any assurance. Okay, they won't give you reliability of data. See, suppose something happens, after some time the data will be recovered and send it to the user, which cannot be happening in the unlicensed Wi-Fi. This is what they have talked about, the short range, medium range and long range. Shall we all go for the second constraint, people? What is my second constraint? Frequency bands. That is what I explained you now. The frequency bands are the bands licensed and unlicensed with the short range, medium range and the long range. Okay, you can just write the same thing. How the powers are compared using the battery powered, how the frequency bands are separated between these ranges, and you just write about the frequency band is two things. One is licensed and you write about the unlicensed spectrum. Okay, you got it, the frequency bands, people. You just talk about reliability and interference of data being exchanged between the objects. So you can write only about that in the frequency bands. So third one, power consumption. Third one, everyone are getting it, people. So when you are connecting the smart objects, which is my smart object, people, this actuator, sensors, all those are my smart objects. So when you are connecting them, you have to follow certain constraints. The first constraint was my range, the area of coverage. Okay, next is frequency band. Frequency band is whether it is a licensed or unlicensed. Okay, what is this frequency bands? These are the providers which actually they give those frequency bands in which they have to communicate. Okay, so you can write for the unlicensed, we don't have reliability of data and interference of data happens more in unlicensed data. And you write only this much is more than enough, people. You need not to read the textbook. Only the diagram, if you see also, it's fine. So shall we go for the third point? Third point is power consumption. I can see girls are all writing. Very nice. Thank you, people. Very good. Third one, power consumption. Okay. Now, speaking about the power consumption, can anyone tell me, unmute your data and unmute your microphone and tell me what are the two types of power consumption that we can have when connecting the IoT devices? Anyone?
AC and DC.
AC and DC? People, can we say it as two types? One, directly you're connecting to the power supply. The other one, using the batteries. There are only these two options available when you connect any objects in the IoT. So, power consumption constraint here in our IoT devices are, one, directly connecting the power supply to the devices. The second one is connecting them through the Bluetooth. Okay, now the problem with this two we will see, and the advantages and the disadvantage will explain us the power consumption. People, I'll make it really simple for you. I just wrote it in three lines for you people to understand the power consumption. So when we take any power connected IoT devices, what is the problem there is, you can only connect through certain distance between the two objects. That is, there won't be restriction between the communication between the devices. There won't be any restriction. There will be restriction only to the mobility. That is, when you are taking the IoT sensors, say suppose you are in the house or you are in your working place and your IoT devices in the house. Okay, you can't carry your power supply here and there. Though if you carry the power supply and connect it also, there is a constraint of mobility. Whereas when you use the battery embedded connected IoT devices, we are not considered about any mobility issues. Okay, here I'm not talking anything regarding the communication problem. Here I'm talking about only the mobility of the IoT devices when you connect it. Got it, people? So when you are doing in your project also, you have to look into the constraint. Whether you are using a battery power to your IoT devices or you are directly connecting the power supply in the college. Say suppose you are projecting your project and say suppose it is not working. So you should have the battery backup, right? So most of the battery powers that we are using right now in the industries or anywhere else last up to 5 to 6 years, it seems. You know why? Because IoT devices are constructed in such a way that it requires very low power consumption. Got it, people? So you take any battery powers and you don't require a very big batteries here to actually connect your IoT devices. Because most of the IoT devices and the technologies that is presently available are low powered consumed. Got it, people? Yes? So what is the next topic, people, after power consumption?
Topology.
Okay. Here, in our IoT technology, we use three topologies. One is star, second one is mesh, fourth one is peer-to-peer. First one is star, second one is mesh, third one is peer-to-peer topology. Okay, let me talk about the star topology, people. In star topology, how will your star topology look, people? Just like that, our IoT devices will be connected. Okay? Okay, here our star topology supports two types of medium. One is the short range and the longer range, not the medium range. Okay, our star topology supports two types of ranges. One is short and the largest topology. It doesn't support the medium topology. I'll tell you why in the later stages. Okay, and the example of the star topology is that it uses a central base station. You know, people, there will be one center station where all the other nodes will be connected. So all the nodes will be controlled by the central base station. Okay. So this base station will connect all the other devices and support the devices communication. We call it a star topology. Next, coming to peer-to-peer communication. Okay, this peer-to-peer communication you can use for any range unless it supports the communication within the range. Rajshekhar, what are you doing? Why are you disturbing the class? Sudeep, what happened? What happened? Don't disturb the class. Okay, peer-to-peer communication, as long as they are within the range, we can use them in any range, okay, whether short range, medium range or large range. Now, I'll give you an example of the star topology. Okay, when you use indoor Wi-Fi's, we call it as a star topology. It's a star topology supports indoor Wi-Fi's. Okay, when it goes for the outdoor Wi-Fi's, for example, mall and all, they use mesh topology. They use mesh topology. So people, you write about the topology only three things. Okay, in our IoT access technology, they support only three. One is star, peer-to-peer, and mesh. Okay, so this is about the topology. Next one is constrained devices. Constrained devices. See, this question they have asked last year, constrained devices. Okay. What and all that the devices will have constraint when you are connecting people? Can anyone tell me? What are all the constraint that you can have when you are connecting this IoT devices? Can anyone tell me? Security, very good. Storage, can I say storage? Yeah. Storage. Power. Networking, very good. Rajshekhar, very good. Memory, computing. So these are the constrained devices, certain constraint that we have when we are connecting into very good IP versions. We will divide them into five basic categories. What and all constraint? The first one is computing. Hope everyone is writing. Computing. Second one is memory. Third one is storage. Fourth one, power. And the fifth one is networking. Fifth one is networking. So, the IoT access technologies, we have certain constraint nodes. Okay, so we will divide them into three basic classes, class 0, class 1, and class 2. I'll tell you in a single line, that's more than enough people. You can write it by yourself. See, I'm telling about what and all the devices can have constraint. We know it's about storage, the memory, the power, and how the networking and how they are actually computing. Based on this, we will divide them into three classes. Okay. First one is class 0. Usually, these are the nodes where it uses only 10 KB of memory. Yeah, someone put some message, but by the time I could read, it went off. Okay, well, let me see some doubt. Ma'am, storage and memory area, same thing, right? Yeah, yeah. See, the storage and memory is the same thing when it comes to how the power supply is being connected. Okay, and a lot of constraints are there in that also. So class 0, we will divide all the nodes which uses less than 10 KB of memory. Okay, the problem with this kind of nodes when connected to the internet is they cannot directly access our internet protocol stack. Okay, the problem is only one thing is you cannot do anything, or you cannot directly access or implement your IP stack. And usually this class 0 constraints, the nodes can be used only in the unlicensed wireless technology. Okay, unlicensed wireless technology. So this is about the class 0 and its definition. So I repeat, class 0, this class is severely constrained because they use only less than 10 KB of memory. Okay, and they cannot access or implement or use the resources from the IP protocol stack. Okay, and where are they used? They are used only in the unlicensed wireless technology. Used only in the unlicensed wireless technology. People, important question. They have asked many times this one. If they ask, generally they will ask you the constraint, all three you can write, all the five you can write, or individually they will ask you. Okay, next comes class 1. Next comes class 1. Pushpa, I think your brother is also listening to the class. Huh? Tell him not to disturb Pushpa. Send him that side. Okay, class 1. These are the nodes which support up to 10 KB RAM. Okay, while this is slightly greater than class 0 nodes, we know that. Okay, it supports up to 10 KB RAM. They can easily communicate with the IP stack. They can easily communicate with the IP stack. And this class 1 nodes can easily communicate over the network with the help of a gateway. They can easily communicate with the network with the help of a gateway. And they also support necessary security functions. Support security functions. So these are class 1 constrained nodes. Okay. I repeat, they support up to 10 KB RAM class 0 is up to 10 KB. Class 1 is from 10 KB to 100 KB flush. Okay. And they can easily access the IP protocol stack. And they can solve all their security issues. And these are the class 1 nodes. Majority of us are using this class 1 nodes. The next one is class 2. Class 2 nodes. They actually support more than 50 KB of memory to 250 KB of memory. 50 to 250 KB of memory. So their initial storage capacity is 50 KB. 50 to 250 KB of memory. They can be fully integrated in our IP networks. They can be fully integrated in our IP networks. Example, a smart power meter. Example, smart power meters. They support class 2 nodes. Class 2 nodes. People, these are the nodes which have been utilized in the the satellite systems, people, where highly sensitive information over a long distance ranges, they use such kind of nodes. So when we talk about the constrained devices, we divide them into three categories: class 0, class 1, and class 2. In simple, class 0 supports up to 10 KB of memory, class 1 up to 100 KB of memory, class 2 up to 250 KB of memory. Okay, based on that, we can actually divide the nodes and actually connect them to through the network. Okay, what is the last topic? Constrained node networks. Okay, this is the last topic. Your half of the chapter is almost done, people. Constrained node network. Okay. Here, what we are doing here is we are limiting certain networks. Okay. For example, in networks with a losey power or a low power networks, we will have a constraint over it. Okay. Why are we having the constraint over the lossy networks or low power is, we all already know that if our networks are really slow, we cannot obtain the reliability of the data. Okay, and lot of interference will happen, which will actually delay the data or loss of data or the connection between the devices are not proper. So we have to have a constraint over node networks. Sorry about it. One second. I'll just rotate it. Okay, so these are the things that you have to write. So in the second chapter of your module 2 is talking about how the devices are connected and what are the different access technologies. So your half of the chapter is done. Anyone have any doubts, please ask me. Here we spoke about how the nodes are all connected. Basically, we connect them differentiating based on their range, frequency bands, their topology. What else, people? Topology and strain node. Now, if everyone got a brief idea, then I go for the next topic. You have to learn what is a sensor, actuator, smart objects, and how they are connected networks. That is the one full chapter. Coming to the next chapter, you have only two things to be learned. One, how these objects are connected. That is what we learned based on the range, frequency band, topology, constraint nodes, constraint node networks. All these things are the first half. Okay, the second half is, now that we are going to learn now, is the IoT access technologies. People, I thought little slow, I will do it here because I have little constraint over the class today. So we'll just push it over. I'm not going to leave any points here. So let's learn it. I just want you people to write few points and then I will just tell you what all the technologies that we are going to use. So let's begin. Okay, IoT access technology, the next topic. IoT access technology. Believe me, if you read today or tomorrow, this module 2, you can read it very soon. And if you delay it and read it after 1 week, it will be difficult, people, because a lot of theory things are there. But it is actually very easy. Whatever I have told, if you read, that's more than enough. Okay, you can write it and I have covered all the points that has to be told. Okay, so next last topic in this module is IoT access technologies. Okay. This IoT access technology, we are talking about the range from 2007 to till date. Okay, so they are all using this medium range. We spoke, no, the range, short range, medium range and long range. So most of my IoT technologies or the one which you are using in your project comes in this medium range. Okay, and most of the technologies are used currently in the market. So whatever the IoT devices that you use are these technologies that you are going to use. Okay, so this will address certain points. Like first one, it will address the standardization and alliances. It will address standardization and alliances. Second one, physical layer. We'll learn about the physical layer of the technologies. Third one, MAC layer. Fourth one, topology. Fifth one, security. Sixth one, competitive technologies. competitive technology. People, now whatever the IoT access technology, the five IoT access technologies, you have to address all these things. One, you have to address what is their standardization, what is that physical layer they use, MAC layer, what topology they use, what kind of security they provide, and what are the competitive technologies they support. So now let's learn the five smart object technologies. Number one, I want you people to write only this five. Rest I will talk by myself. I don't want any writing. These 5 points you have to write. Technologies for connecting the smart object. What are the my IoT technologies? Number one, IEEE 802.15.4. IEEE 802.15.4. This is the first IoT access technology. Okay. Second IoT access technology is the same thing. IEEE 802.15.4G. Small letter G. 4G. And IEEE 802.15.4E. The second access technology is IEEE 802.15.4G and IEEE 802.15.4E. This is the second technology. The third one, IEEE 1901.2A. IEEE 1901.2A. 2A, A for Apple. Third one, okay. Fourth one, IEEE 802.11AH. A for Apple, H for hat. AH. IEEE 802.11AH. Fifth, last one, LORA. LORAWAN. Can anyone tell me what is it? You know what is WAN? What is LoRa?
Low range
people. Low range wide area network. Okay. Now I don't want you people to write anything. You just listen to me. So most of the technologies that what I'm talking now is the important one. So every time they ask only these questions, that whatever I'm going to take for the next 15 minutes. That's all. Next 15 minutes. It's all done, people. Class will be done in 15 minutes. So please listen. And majority, whatever I'm covering now, will be asked as your second question in your module 2. Okay? So first question is all done now. The second question that you can expect from, which question that is? Third question or fourth question will be these questions, whatever I'm talking to you now. Okay? So let's begin. What is my first IEEE 802.15.4 is? This is why one of the format, the technology supported by IoT. Okay, this is an older version, but currently being used in the wireless protocol to connect all these smart objects. Okay, this is the older version, but still there most of us are using this technology. Okay, for the wireless connecting smart objects. So where do we use this IEEE 802.15.4? In the connecting all the wireless smart objects. Okay. Second one, IEEE 802.15.14G and 4E, these are usually used in the technologies where utilities and smart cities. We learned, no people, smart city, smart building, autonomous vehicle, all those things will support this technology. Which technology? IEEE 802.14.4G and 4E. They support smart cities and utilities. So this technology is usually used in smart cities. Third one, IEEE 1901.2A. These technologies are used for connecting the smart objects over power lines, where most of the smart objects really depending on the power lines, we will use such technology. 1901.2A, power line, over the power lines. Nowhere specified people in brief, giving you the brief points through which you can write the complete history. Okay. And the fourth one, IEEE 802.11AH. these are well known built for connecting the smart object for Wi-Fi standards. When we are using Wi-Fi and some smart objects are connected, so such smart object uses a technology which is 802.11ah. 8.2.11ah. The last one, the low range wide area network. These technologies are designed for the long distance with power requirements. Long distance power requirements in unlicensed spectrum. In unlicensed spectrum. Okay, now today class you will be learning the only the first one. If you learn the first one, the rest four is just the addition of it. Okay, if we learn this first technology, the diagram, the basic field diagram, everything, you can similarly write for the rest four technologies. The last four I'll be taking in the next class. Okay, today we are going to learn only the first technology. If you learn this completely, you can write the other four technology which has slight differences in their format, field format. Okay, rest everything is same people. You don't get afraid reading the textbook. These are the five technologies that they support. And you learn the first one, the rest one will be very easy. So let's begin today's class, the end of the topic today's class, which is IEEE 802.15.4. Now, I don't want anyone to read or anyone to write. Just listen to me. Listen to me. So this format I already told you we are using for connecting the smart object for the wireless technologies. Okay, the main focus of this IEEE 802.15.4 is they mainly depend on reliability, latency, and CSMA and CSMA. I'm looking at the chat. Collision sense, multiple access. Forgot network, sir. What is CSMA, CA? Anyone can answer what is CA? Collision avoidance, people. So such networks, our IEEE 802.15.4 standard technology supports. Okay, so you please remember we are connecting the smart objects for the wireless technologies where we are mainly concentrating on reliability and latency. We can use such technologies. Got it, people? So smart object which requires reliability and latency, we will use this technology. Okay, next, I told you people, when you are writing about any one of this technology, you have to address all the five issues. What are all the five issues? First, you have to address the standardization and alliance. Second, you have to talk about the physical layer, MAC layer, topology, security, and competitive technologies. So when you're, if they ask you any one of the technology in the exam, you have to write all, address all these five things. Okay. First one is standardization and alliance for the IEEE 802.15.4. Okay. Here, this standardization supports low complexity wireless devices. Okay. And they support a WPAN, wireless personal area networks. Okay. Standardization and runs on batteries. These technologies runs on batteries. Very simple, flexible, and easy to install. Okay, so this is all about standardization and reliance. People, in the textbook, they have explained almost 1.5 pages for this. You need not to write anything. Whatever I have told you now, you can write. So they support low complexity wireless devices, number one. And they support WPAN, wireless personal area network. They run on batteries, very simple, flexible, and easy installation. And you can just make a theory of it because most of the points I have covered from those 1.5 pages. Okay, so this is all about standardization and alliance. Next comes about the, what is that we have to address is the physical layer. When it comes to physical layer, we have to consider this OSI format, people. What are the 7 layers that we have? From the top, application, presentation, session layer, transport, network, data link and physical layer. So my this standard, which is IEEE 802.15.4, support the top five layers, which is my application, presentation, session, transport, and network. Okay, they sit on these five layers and rule it. Okay, they do all the things that they have to do in connecting the devices. Okay, now when you consider any protocol stack which is supporting the top five layers of my OSI layer, there are certain protocols that you have to follow. These questions repeatedly they have asked in all the three papers, what are the different protocols supported by IEEE 802.15.4. Okay, there are 7 protocols. I want you people to write the 7 protocols. First one is ZigBee. Make it fast, people. ZigBee. Second one, 6LOWPAN. 6LOWPAN. I'll explain you in a single line everything. It's very easy, people. Third one, ZigBee. ZigBee IP. ZigBee Internet Protocol. Next one, ISA 111A. ISA 111A. This is one of the protocol. Next one, Wireless HART. 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 Wireless HART. The next one, Thread. Next one, Thread. Okay, people, listen to me. In just single line, I will explain you. These are the 6 protocols being supported by my IEEE, the first access technology. What is the ZigBee is doing is, this is the protocols which is being used in our home automation and building a healthcare devices or building automation or building cities and all. We use this ZigBee protocol. Okay, next 6, LOPAN, that is low wireless personal area network. It uses IP version 6. Okay, it uses IP version 6. It means that your network layer protocol supports IP version 6 to transfer the packets. That is 6, LOPAN. Okay, next one, ZigBee IP. Okay, these are the protocols which adopts 6LOWPAN. They adopt the 6LOWPAN protocol and improves the security. The next one, ISA 111A. These are actually developed by International Society of Automation for wireless system. So this is one of the standard. They have a set of rules. When you're connecting any object to any technology, you have to follow those rules. Okay, these are developed by International ISA, International Society of Automation. International Society of Automation for wireless system. Next, Wireless HART. This is one more protocol. Okay, generated by IEEE 802.15.4. Okay, these are promoted by HART, HART Communication Foundation. They are promoted by HART, HART Communication Foundation. HART Communication Foundation. When you use such protocol, their mainly concentration is on self-organization, self-healing, and time synchronization. So when you use such protocol, they support self-organization, self-healing, and time synchronization. Okay. The last one is Thread Protocol. These are constructed on top of the 6LOWPAN. They are constructed on 6LOWPAN IP version 6. Constructed on top of the 6LOWPAN IP version 6. Okay, when you use such protocols, they mainly consider security, reliability and security. And they use mesh network they use mesh network to connect all the products at the home. Say suppose if they ask you IEEE 802.15.4 and they ask the protocols, you have to write all these 6 protocols, people. Okay, so what is this? Is nothing but these are the technologies where they have their own set of rules that they have to follow. So there are 6 type of different types of protocols. One is ZigBee IP, 6LoWPAN, ISA 111A, okay, wireless HART and thread. Okay, another 5 minutes I'll be completing your class. Please listen, just 5 more minutes. So ZigBee. Now let's learn the ZigBee architecture. ZigBee. Okay, so when actually this ZigBee protocol actually were evolved supporting the technologies is in 2004, okay, where 100 companies started using this ZigBee protocol. Now gradually it has ended up to 400 companies that they support this ZigBee protocol. They started with 100 companies and now 400 companies are using it. They provide lot of the internet problem solutions to be overcome. When you use ZigBee protocol, okay, when you are connecting the devices over the network, many network issues and all can be overcome when you use such protocol. The main aim of ZigBee is to sense, okay, and use the object with the low power and bandwidth. The main objective of ZigBee protocol is to for the sensors and the object with the low power and the bandwidth. 2-3 minutes, people, over. Okay, over. Listen, because this is the climax, which every time they ask you about the ZigBee protocol. If you learn, if you understand it, you can just write it. Okay, so they have several revisions that they are doing from years. I told you 2004, no, till date, we have the ZigBee protocol technology used in our home appliances, where they keep changing the commands and the message type, the fields and all. So that we get upgraded and most of the protocol supports our internet. Got it, people? Because earlier I told you we were using IP version 4. Now we try to use IP version 6 because our objects have been increased and the number of objects being connected is also increased, where it does not support all the addressing formats of IP version 4. So we go for IP version 6. Okay, 2-3 minutes, please listen. ZigBee protocol. Your life-saving protocol. Every time they ask this, when they ask in the internals or the externals, they will ask this. So I told you these are the objects which support the low power or a low battery or a low bandwidth objects. Okay, and their different function is mainly about the lighting controlled devices. So smart objects like temperature, lighting control, this ZigBee protocol supports. So well known where and all the ZigBee protocols are used is they're used in automation for commercial, retail, home applications. They uses in the commercial, retail, home applications and smart energies. Okay, so our ZigBee protocol utilizes this IEEE 802.15.4. okay, where they are used at the lower physical and MAC layer. They are usually used in physical and MAC layer. Tankaraj, sit properly, Tankaraj. Good boy, sit properly. Over. 2 minute, ruko. I'll ask you questions, Tankaraj. Be ready. Okay? Okay. Then only I'll leave others to leave the session. Listen about the ZigBee protocol. I'll ask you a question now. Okay, ZigBee utilizes at the lower physical and the MAC layer. Okay, and okay, how actually the layer format we all know, people. Just we will take one protocol stack. Okay, now each protocol stack, I will tell you what it is. From lower layer, I will tell you what it is. Okay, the diagram is there in the book. Okay, so first lower layer is my physical layer. Then comes my MAC layer. Please imagine your protocol stack with 5 layers. The lower layer is a physical layer. The upper layer is a MAC layer. Put together is my IEEE 802.15.4. And above that comes my two entity layer. Above that comes my application layer. And on that, it comes my application and profiles of my ZigBee. Okay, I repeat, my ZigBee protocol stack, the lower two is my physical and MAC layer supported by IEEE 802.15.4, above which comes my network and security layer. The main concentration is on all about the security over the network. Then comes the application layer, above which is the application layer of the ZigBee. That is how one application to the other applications you are connecting over the network. Okay, so ZigBee follows the network startup. Then main aim is for configuring, routing, and securing the communication. The main aim of ZigBee is they use for configuration, routing, and secured communication. How they are doing the routing is they have their own routing table people. They keep changing the topology based on the requirement. Say suppose there are only few in objects that has to be connected, they'll use the star topology. And they want to increase the objects, increase the object connecting, they go for peer-to-peer. And they want a lot of objects to be connected, they go for mesh topology. So ZigBee supports all the topologies. Okay, the last 1 minute, all done people, the last 1 minute. Okay, next I'm talking about ZigBee IP. Okay, till now I was speaking about the ZigBee. Okay, now I'm speaking about the ZigBee IP, Internet Protocol. Okay, just like the protocol stack, which I have drawn here, there are six layers. The bottom layer is my physical and MAC layer, which is supported by IEEE 802.15.4. Okay, after physical and MAC, in ZigBee, it was network and security layer. But here in ZigBee IP, we have six LOW PAN application layer. Okay, that is, what they are doing is they are using this low power local area network for connecting, above which they have IP version 6, above which they have UDP or TCP, above which they have a ZigBee IP protocol. There's a small difference between a ZigBee and IP people. In ZigBee, there is no IP version 6 or 6 low pan. Okay, in ZigBee Internet Protocol, we are using it because in ZigBee Internet Protocol supports both wireless and wired network because we are using our UDP and TCP, which is not there in a ZigBee, just a normal ZigBee protocol. Okay, so this is all about IEEE 802.15.4. Today we learned the first access technology. There are four more access technology. If you learn this, the others you can write it by yourself. In the next class, other four technologies I will be teaching you. And